foundations in the family. It's like a man marrying a dog. Unbelievers are dogs. Believers are children of God. And so when you marry an unbeliever, it's a man marrying a dog. Two of you will have two different foundations in the house. And so you can't, it can't work. It can't work. But when two of you are right with God, your hearts have been transformed by God. And your heart is love sending. You send love. When you want to talk to your husband, what do you say? Love. When you want to talk to your wife, what do you say? Love. You no longer say bitterness. You no longer say hatred. You no longer say dissatisfaction. You know, some people, especially ladies, when they will express so much dissatisfaction, as if there is another place you will be more satisfied. It is what Adam calls a thing that the thing is. If I suddenly think in my mind, now I say, oh, this place is hot, this place is hot. Oh, hold me, hold me. The people will say, what's wrong with you, mama? I say, this place, he. But you guys will say, here is no hot. Where? She says, you see, you will rush me with umbrella because I call it like that. That's how marriage is. Whatever you call your marriage, that is what your marriage is. If you say sweet, 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 it will become sweet. If you say trouble, 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 what happened?
Trouble, 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 marriage.
So, put your hand in your heart. Say, my heart.
My heart.
You are a love sending heart.
You are a love sending heart.
Say it and let your heart hear. My heart, you are a love sending. Say it, let your heart hear.
My heart, you are a love sending heart.
Say it and let the gates of hell hear you. Amen.
Amen.
So from today, what will your heart send out?
Love.
Love. And how does the heart send out love? Through your mouth, through your words. Through your ways in a relationship, ways that can build. The second thing about relationship, godly relationship, is that you place value on one another. You place value on what? One another. A relationship that does not place value on one another is a failed relationship. There is none of you that is useless. And some couples, the men, come to this now for men. I told you for women. Let me tell you for men. You say, this is my wife. She is a liability. I said, He said, she is a liability, mama. I said, say it again. What does that mean? So the value of your wife is what? Liability. Hey, I say right away from the crown of her head to the sole of her feet. All that you can value her is that she's a liability. Maybe because she's not working. Maybe she's not contributing economically. But she's contributing in other areas. She's cleaning the house. She's cooking. She does go wrong. And she serves you on bed.
Speak it, mother, speak it.
So what are you now saying? That she's completely useless? That she's a liability, it's a debt? Liability means debt.
Men are wicked.
So I say, no, please. So you place value. Even our children, we must place value on them. And let them know that we value them. Like I keep telling my last child, like when I got to this place, I wrote a mail to her. I said, what could I have done without you? What would she prepare my buses? She did that, place my clothes, say, Mom, this is day one cloth, day two cloth, this is, you know, she arranged everything, took me out, drove me. What will I do? That's a child. What will I have done without her? She's a PhD student, but she does everything for me, cook for me, do. That's a child. And so I place so much, so much value. And I kept telling her, what will I do without you? She does my social medias. So that's it. So what will we do without one another? Yesterday we saw what we demonstrated. These guys are young guys. They helped me and this big man could not take me. So you place value on your relationship, the person you are relating with. Don't look down on anybody in relationship. Don't. When you learn to place value on people, that leads you to appreciate people. And whoever you appreciate will appreciate in value. And then the reward will come back to you. That is appreciating the person. When I appreciate you, sister, like what you just did to me this evening, I told you I deeply appreciate it and I meant it. Next time, you will think of me. You see, that day I gave this woman something, she deeply. I did not say I appreciate. I said I deeply. And I say it publicly, I deeply appreciate. You see, so you will now think. But when you don't place value on people, you depreciate people. And when you depreciate people, you cannot harvest out of a life you depreciate. When you depreciate your wife, you can harvest out of your wife. When you depreciate your husband, you cannot appreciate. You cannot reap from what you have depreciated. For whatever you depreciate will depreciate. And so there will be no harvest. Thank you. Everybody say thank you, Jesus.
Thank you.
Jesus Christ was not like the Pharisees and the Sadducees who depreciated people and said, this is a sinner. And then they say again, this is a what? A lame? A blind? The leprous, God, don't touch anybody. But Jesus Christ was appreciating everybody. He found the sinners. He brought them. And Papa kept telling us, as a pastor, that we are people-centered. We are human beings-centered. So many people keep talking to us, especially me. They say, Mama, you can sit there to listen to anybody. I say, who is anybody? Everybody you have found face to face with you is important. Important. I have been with HIV, you know, AIDS patient. And they said, don't allow their tears to touch you. They wept on me. I took them in deliverance. They will vomit on me. I'm not after their vomiting on me. I am after their healing. I am after the demon of AIDS getting out of them and they restore. And many of them that I use my life to follow in deliverance, driving out the demons, and they cry and they wept on me, vomited on me, they are healed today. And so, I didn't say, oh, these ones are death materials. Even when they come, they will say, Mom, I've killed myself. So we write themselves out. I say, no, they have a value. You are not dead, you are alive. You are not useless, you are an evangelist. Tell your neighbor, place value on people.
Place value on people.
To die, let them know that somebody still values them. There are some, they will lock them up in the house. HIV patient. They said they are there. There was a woman. I said, break that door. Break her out of me.
Amen.
Break the door. He said, Mommy, what are you going to do with her? She's finished. We told her not. I said, I did not tell her not. So give me one more chance.
Amen.
And today they are alive.
Amen.
That's important in a relationship. Place value. And this value you are placing on others, don't forget to place on yourself. Say, Lord, I place value on myself. Rahapo sopo. Can you say something good? Plant something good into yourself. Say, Lord, I am wonderful. I am just the best. I place value on myself. Thank you, Lord. Ancient of days. Thank you. If you place value on yourself, you will never commit suicide. Those who commit suicide, you know what happened? They disvalued themselves. They depreciated themselves. They found that they were now useless. So what happened? They shoot themselves or take some tablets. I come against the spirit that will make you hate yourself.
Amen.
So, the second thing in a godly relationship is that you place value on your spouse, on the person that you are relating with. When you place value, you affirm the value and you mention the contribution so much. You know, when I came, one of the things that Pastor Joseph told me when I arrived 3 days ago is that, Mommy, thank my wife. My wife has been there for me. My wife has been with me in all troubles, in all temptation. Without my wife, I don't know what I would have done. That's it. He placed value. He mentioned the contributions of the wife. And I told the wife, I said, this is what your husband said. And thank you. You mention. Everybody say mention.
Mention.
Constantly the contribution of another person to your life. Sometimes you test your husband, you test your wife, and say, have a great day. You have been so much a support to my life. Two of you left the house. But during the day, mention to him, mention to her, what contribution? Number three, and I will, there are seven, but I will do these three and maybe finish the remaining one because it's already 8:26 by my time and we need to close. Number three, pray for the person. Say, pray for the person.
Pray for the person.
Always. And tell him or her that you are praying. For a godly relationship to work out, you need a lot of prayers. Because the enemy will not want brethren to dwell together in love and in unity. The scripture says it is there that God commands his blessing. And so God, the enemy will not want it. And the only way to drive out the enemy is by prayer. And so you thank God. You keep praying. And say, Lord, you know love is life. And God is love. And you begin to say, God, I cannot nurse this relationship. I cannot nurse my love for this man. I cannot nurse my love for this woman. I cannot nurse my love. Please nurse our love because you are love. Nurse our love because you are love. I cannot nurse the love of brethren in this church. Nurse our love. Nurse our love. When I got to the present parish, I am pastoring by the grace of God. It was a parish of everybody doing their thing. When I got there, I was strange because I was coming from a parish where we share love a lot. And I began to pray. When I talked to this one, he said, no, me, I can't go. Even when we feast house fellowship, he said, this road separates me and her. I don't go to her. I said, you are in the same church.
Yes.
And I started praying. Father, nurse our Lord. Nurse. The last family week we did, when I told them visit one another, I told them I'm going home because I live far away. They didn't know I would return. By 3:30, I told my husband I'm on my way. I said to the church, I went. I saw them pack from family to family. I saw them eating together. I saw them celebrating. I saw them exchanging gifts. I said, oh God, you have lost our love. Do you want to love anybody? This night, can you pray and say, Father, nurse our love. Can you pray, please? I don't know who you just, you want to love your children? Do you want to love your wife? Do you want to love anyone that you want to love? Please call that person. I am giving you opportunity to pray. This is the last point I'm making. So just call the person and say, Lord, nurse. My Father, I bring, oh God, members of this church together. I ask that you will nurse their Lord. Raheda Sandaye Kebua Dazayahada, nurse their Lord. I am praying, my God and my King, that you will feed their love. I ask that you feed their love. I ask that you feed their love. Fire their love. Ignite their love. Raheke Bosotaya. Bosodole Kedaha. Zodahike Bosua. Eba Santa Logo Hodo. Zeye Kenda Zayahalu. Zekedaha. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
May the Lord nurse your love.
Amen.
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 Oh. I want to close the meeting at that point. I have 4 more points to add, and I believe that before the family celebration on Sunday, I'll finish that. But I may give just one room to one just question. Before we pray, is there anyone that has a question either on what we taught yesterday or today? Yes, sir.
Yes. Hallelujah.
Amen.
This is my question. Praying for someone, is it good that while you are praying for them to tell them that I am in prayers with you, is not blowing a trumpet?
Yeah. You see, if it is your wife, if it's your child, if it's somebody around you, why can you not tell them that you are praying for them? Jesus Christ told Peter, Satan wants to save you like a wheat. Completely. What did he say?
But I have prayed for you.
So if it were wrong, Jesus won't say it. He said, I have prayed for you. He said, when you are delivered, strengthen your prayer. And Paul said to the church in Ephesus, he said to Timotheus, I am praying for you. Paul said, I pray for you with what? Tears. And Samuel said, oh, that it will be against me, it will be a sin, if I cease to pray for you openly. He declared, as long as you are doing it, it becomes hypocrisy when you don't do it and you say you do. But if you are actually praying, you have to confidently tell those that you pray for, that you pray for them. You are not saying it to boast up. You are saying it to encourage them that you pray for them. I'm sure. Any other question? Okay. So shall we rise to say a word of prayers? And I hand over to the pastor. Godly relationship. For a godly relationship to take place, an ungodly relationship must go. I don't know if you have any ungodly relationship. Tonight, you can let it go. for you cannot eat from two tables at this.